Ngā waka, ngā mana, ngā reo, ngā mai haere mai koutou ki te whare wānanga o Waikato. Ngā mai haere mai ki te kauhau o te amakapua Mere Berryman. E te marikura o Mere, tanako. Ngā kaimahi o te whare wānanga, e rā rangatira mā, tēnā koutou katoa. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Neil Quigley. I'm the Vice Chancellor of the University. It's my pleasure to welcome you to this inaugural professorial lecture to be given by Professor Mere Berryman. Professor Berryman is of Ngāi Tūhoe, Ngāti Ngāua, and Ngāti Whare descent. Mere completed her teaching certificate from Hamilton Teachers College in the mid-1970s. For the next 20 years, she worked as a school teacher in primary and intermediate schools throughout the Waikato and Bay of Plenty. In 1995, Mere left teaching to look for more effective responses to the educational and social disparities faced by Māori students and their families. Together with a colleague, Emeritus Professor Ted Glynn, they sought funding to set up a research centre. Specialist education services agreed to support them, and the Potama Punamu Education Research and Development Centre was formed. While working full-time as an emerging researcher, Mere was encouraged by elders to enrol at the University of Waikato to complete her teaching qualifications. In 2000, when special education services went back to the Ministry of Education, Mere was asked to be director of Putama Punamu. At the time, the research whānau received leadership support from iwi elders and worked closely with academics from the University of Waikato. Of note was their contribution to the genesis of Te Kotahitanga with Emeritus Professor Russell Bishop. In 2010, having completed her PhD, Mere agreed to work full-time for the Faculty of Education as a Senior Research Fellow. In 2012, Mere took the Director's position in Phase 5 of Te Kotahitanga. This was followed by her direction of the Building on Success Kia Eki Panuku initiative adopted by a third of New Zealand's secondary schools from 2014 to 2016. At the culmination of Kia Eki Panuku, Potama Punamu, the name of the initial research centre, was used to bring together a group of people to work within the Ministry's latest community of learning, Kahui Ako, a professional development policy space. This team is now working with school leaders and teachers across New Zealand throughout our education system to create more equitable opportunities for Māori to achieve as Māori. In 2016, for her services to education and to Māori in education, Mere was made an officer of the New Zealand Order of Merit. During 2017, she was a finalist in the Kiwi Bank New Zealander of the Year Awards. Mere's research includes kaupapa Māori and critical theories, culturally responsive methodologies, relational and responsive inclusion, school and home community relationships, and cultural relationships for responsive pedagogy. She's published widely in all of these fields. E Mere, ke te tangi tonu te ngākau ki te rangatira o Tauranga Moana kia morihu. Nā reira, ke te hoki ngamahara kia ia. Mā ngā mihi āraha anō hoki ki ōna marae, ki ngā hapū me ngā iwi o Tauranga Moana. Nā reira, e te marakura, e te amakapua, Ngāi Tūhoe, Ngāti Awa, Ngāti Whare. Nā mai whakatau mai, nā mai haere mai rā. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Professor Mere Berryman to give her inaugural professorial lecture.
ngā mana, I ngā reo, I ngā maunga, I ngā awa-awa, I ngā pātaka o ngā taonga tuku iho. Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā tātou katoa. So, the title of my inaugural professorial address is something that I've been thinking about now quite closely for a number of years. And the piece that I really want to think about is our choice. That's my choice, that's your choice, that's our choice. Our choice to make education a place where Māori students feel that they really belong, or do we continue to force them to fit into our classrooms? So, a little bit about me. Is my meeting house, Rongo Kārai, in the Ruatoki Valley, and my mum and dad, my whakapapa, who I am. My parents were both, according to my birth certificate, full-blooded New Zealand Māori. Their first language was te reo Māori, and yet they learned very quickly that if they wanted their children to do well and succeed in the education system, they kept that language between themselves. We were very fortunate in that they didn't keep the tikanga to themselves. And so we were brought up very much within a worldview that was Māori. However, I have to say that that's me. That's my experience of education. I learned to play the game. I learned to fit in. And one of my most embarrassing memories at school is that I won a competition, and the competition was about assimilation, and I was supporting it. So I've come a little bit along the way. But one of the things that I learned when I put on that mask, when I left my culture at school gate, when I learned to play the game that was education, was I set myself up to be vilified by both Māori and non-Māori. So I know many people who experienced education like that. I know my children experienced education like that. And I believe that we have it in our power to ensure that education does not continue like that for Māori students. So I succeeded in school, but my brothers, well, on the other hand, they couldn't quite understand when metaphorically they used to do the haka, they were trotted off down to the headmaster's office. I did become a teacher, and as you've heard, I left teaching because I found that I was becoming part of the problem. So my choice was to step outside of the education system to look for solutions. One of the solutions I found is in this notion of critical theory by Paulo Freire. The statement that education either functions as an instrument which is used to facilitate integration of the younger generation into the fabric of the present system and bring about conformity, I think is the reason I had to put on that mask. And my sons, less successfully, I remember one of my best pieces of advice to my younger son, actually, was, you know the game. He said yes, and I said, then play it, because I was powerless to help him do anything else. The piece that I think Paulo Freire is saying below, or it can become the practice of freedom, and that's what I want us to be focused on tonight. And I want us to think about what is your role in this, whether you're a grandmother, whether you're a teacher, whether you're an academic, whether you're a student, what is your role? And where is our agency? Where do we have agency to make a difference? And the last question that I want us to think about is, what do we want our legacy to be in all of this? Looking over the session that I'm about to share with you, it looks something like that. So we'll do a little bit of thinking about the treaty, going back and thinking about the treaty. We'll think a little bit about the opening of identities for Māori students. And we'll think about the concept of Māori order. I want to then present a model, a theoretical model that allows us to really work with schools, and I'm going to share the evidence that comes from that. And as part of that, we'll listen to the voices of students in 2015. So, back to the Treaty of Waitangi. One of the things that we've found in the work that we've done over the last 20 years is that people seem to fit on either end of a continuum in terms of the Treaty of Waitangi. There are people like myself who strive to disrupt the status quo of inequity and enact social justice, because the Treaty of Waitangi promised that to us, promised it to both treaty partners. Or there are people at the other end who say, well, actually, this is a whole old historical document and the best we just get over it. When we think about this whole notion of the Treaty of Waitangi and biculturalism, some people are really afraid of that. Instead, they stick to the notion of a group of people who maintain power and privilege in our schools. But what we're more likely to see are groups of people who move from one end, depending upon the people who are in the room with them, to the other. And I guess we've all been in that experience of thinking, you know, we may not agree with what they're saying, but they're moving along that continuum. And finally, they rest in the middle. Paulo Freire advises us that if you sit in the middle, then actually you are aligning yourself with the most powerful group. And so I want us to think about that, and I also want us to go back to the beginning of the Treaty of Waitangi, which, whether we like it or not, is not going away. It's still there. And one of the things that people I talk with find it hard to believe, that when the Crown gave us those promises, the promises weren't just for iwi. They were for non-Māori as well. They were for Pākehā. And I want, if you are Pākehā, to be thinking about, okay, what have you received from the Treaty of Waitangi? What are the promises that you have received or not? One of the other things I want us to think about tonight are some of the metaphors that we use. And one of the important metaphors that comes out of the Treaty of Waitangi is this notion here, this notion of partnership. And everybody says, yes, we're going to work in partnership. But in my experience, what I find is that partnership is about who has the most power telling the person with the least amount of power how they will engage. So do we really want that to be our legacy? Or do we want the term mana orite to guide this term over here, which was in the minds of the people when they were going through the principles, this notion of mana orite. Mana is a word I think that we have grown to use. That's about the personal prestige, the ascribed power that you have from other people. Orite means the same, so that your mana is seen by both groups as being equal. The statement in orange is something that I've heard students say again and again. When we talk to them about what relationship do you want your teachers to have with you, in one way or the other, that's what I've heard I want them to treat me like they want me to treat them. For me, that's the principle of mana ōrite. It's not about the principle of partnership. So I want us to think about that metaphor as we go through this. The other thing I want us to think quite critically about is this policy, and there is no other country in the world that I've seen that has a policy in education, a strategy and a policy in education that's quite like Kahikitea. Kahikitea came to us from the series of hui that were held by Tūwharetoa, that were hosted by Tūwharetoa with iwi at Tōpū. Kahikitea, for the first time, was a policy that says we have to do something about it. We can no longer blame Māori students, we can no longer blame their communities. We as institutions have to get ready for the students. We have to step up. And the statement within Kahikitea was clear, succinct and simple. Māori students enjoying education. That would be pretty wonderful. But it went on. Māori students enjoying education success. Even that would be something quite novel. But Kahikitea went further and said, Māori students enjoy education success as Māori. What's interesting about that policy, I was working in the ministry when it first came out, and that mirror was held up to us as people who worked in the ministry. We had to show how we, in fact, were stepping up for Māori students and whānau. And I guess we must have done a few things right, because then, of course, for those teachers in the room, it came screaming out to schools, and you were told then to step up. In 2015, we worked with Kia Ke Panaku. Now, 2015, that's the start of it, 2008, 2015, we worked with groups of secondary schools who had no idea what that strategy was, what it looked like, or how it played out in practice. And that's a little bit different for some people. I remember a school principal getting very angry with me, and he said, Mere, if I had a plan of how to do that, don't you think I would have done it last week? Well, I think at the time I was asking the question, we had less surety around what that looked like. But I still find that it's really interesting that we then had to turn around and we had to refresh, was the term they used, refresh Kahikitea in 2013. And I put that up now because in 2017, that was going to stop. And the kāhuiako, or the communities of learning, would take over. So, the other term I want us to think about is really a term that comes to me from this amazing painting of Don's. Don Ratana painted that picture, and I want you to think about it. And I want you to think about the time you've seen the look in that painting, in the eyes in that, that person in the middle. I want you to think about that person as a student. And I found the words for that from Mason Drury. Mason Drury talked about Māori noho, where your Māori, your inner vitality, your inner essence was languishing, where you were not feeling good, where you were not feeling as though you belonged, when you were forced to fit in an education system that was not about you. And what Mason Drury challenged us to do as educators was to think about how do you as educators help students to move from Māori noho to Māori ora, where your Māori is vibrant and is alive. And I think that that is something also that I want us to think about in the model that I'm going to talk through with you now. The model begins with Māori Ora in the centre. There are many groups saying that the child is in the centre. Well, if that child is in the centre, is feeling as though they do not belong in education, then we need to do something about that. So let's be explicit about that, and let's say, let's put children with Māori Ora in the centre of this. The other thing we've taken from Kahikitea, but we've also taken from the voices of students. Students on this side over here, Māori students want to learn, they want to achieve, they want to leave school with qualifications for the future. Whether they're five and going into as a six-year-old, whether they're going from primary school to intermediate, they want the skills to take them further on for the next step, up the potama of learning. But what they also want is they want their cultural identity strong and secure. They do not want to be assimilated. So there's the first part of this model that we're using as a theory of change, a critical theory of change within the kāwhiako model. Down the bottom, the ministry and Eero are using this notion of equity and excellence. Now, as adults, we can define equity and excellence, and I would suggest that we can't define them without also understanding what belonging looks like for the students with whom we work. So there's the framework, there's the sort of the outside parameters, and now this is where the research kicks in. The first context that's up there is the notion of adaptive expertise. Adaptive expertise driving deliberate acts of teaching and learning. These are the teachers who understand the curriculum and how to use the curriculum in the most effective way. They understand how to use evidence. They know how to use pedagogy to engage students. Now, I would suggest that the research shows us, and there it is, John Hattie's effect sizes, that an average teacher can achieve 0.35 in a year, but a good teacher can achieve twice as much, 0.60 in a year. So I would also suggest that many of those effective teachers are working for 80% of the children in our classrooms and schools. But I want us to think about the 20%, and I think it might be growing a little, that education is not working for. The second point on our model, and what we're suggesting, is that those sets should be overlapping. So it's not just that, and it's not just that. It's bringing them together in a coherent and aligned way. So this is the notion of responsive pedagogy and cultural relationships. Many people say, yes, right, I know that, I understand that. But I would say that it's one of the most highly contested terms being used not only in New Zealand, but in other parts of the world. Culturally responsive pedagogy. So I want to talk to you first about some of the evidence that's come out of that, and also about this amazing woman, Gloria Ladson-Billings. And I go back to 1992 when she wrote about a pedagogy of opposition, not unlike critical pedagogy. And she talked, and she called this culturally relevant pedagogy. But one of the things that she said, and when I looked at this, I thought, that's exactly what we're doing. That's exactly our simultaneous success trajectories. First, she said, students must experience academic success. Secondly, she said, students must develop and or maintain cultural competence. Now here she's talking about black Afro-American students in America. And then this last one, students must develop a critical consciousness through which they challenge the status quo of the current social order. Now I think when you start bringing those two things together, you're beginning to get that sort of a synergy. So what effect does that have in schools? Well, Dr. Adrian Alton Lee was asked to evaluate phase 5 of Te Kotahitanga, and she evaluated it in terms of this report, Kahikitia, a demonstration report. And for the first time, what she was able to show for Māori achievement in NCEA using a match peer comparison, so in the red, non-Te Kotahitanga phase 5 schools, and in the green, Te Kotahitanga phase 5 Māori students. So you can see that we started a little bit below the comparison group. But after 3 years, a gap appeared. And what we saw that was that that happened in phase 1, it happened in NCA level 1, NCA level 2, and you can see that the gap got wider, and it also happened in NCA level 3. So that was not an intervention in literacy, it wasn't an intervention in maths, it was an intervention in bringing cultural relationships for responsive pedagogy into classrooms and working with teachers who already had effective adaptive expertise. But understanding how we see cultural relationships is really important. And one of the things that we've learned and we continue to have reinforced is the notion of whānau-type relationships. Whānau-type relationships, family-like relationships, that show actually we care about the students and we have high expectations for their learning. But relationships that also understand who the child is and also allow the students to understand who you are as the teachers. And finally, teachers who have a joint vision of what education success looks like. So the cultural relationships that we specifically talk about with the schools in which we work are those. The pedagogy, on the other hand, and this is not about adding Māori iconography in the room, this is about actually being responsive to the children's prior knowledge and experiences and letting them bring their own cultural toolkit, is what Jerome Brunner calls it, into the learning. So not being the expert teacher and saying, I'm going to tell you Māori kids what it means to be Māori. It's about letting the students tell us what's in their cultural toolkit. It's about learning from students. And the second thing is that notion of reciprocal responsibilities to learn from students and students to learn from students and students to learn from teachers. So you're activating all of the brains in the classroom, unlike what we have now, where I'm standing up here and I'm ranting on and some of you might be asleep and some of you might not. It's about activating all of the brains in the classroom more of the time. And finally, it's about power sharing so that our own sense-making is able to be used in the learning of others. The third and final circle, you'll be pleased, I'm not going for five, is this notion of homeschool and community collaborations. So what does that look like? Well, if you look at chapter 7, yes, you won't be able to read that, I know, but just look at the length of the lines. If you look at chapter 7 in the leadership piece, and I understand we've got one of the authors in the room, you will see this graph in terms of working with home. Now, what we have down the bottom is some negative effects, because homework surveillance, for example, will give you a negative effect. However, the research that the original Potama Kōnanga did is this research up here, which got an effect of 1.81. And what's really important about that effect is that it didn't happen over a year. It happened over a two. So if we want to accelerate learning, and that's what I believe we need to do for the 20%, we have to be thinking about how do we bring those three contexts for learning together more often so that they are actually helping to grow students who believe in themselves and believe in our education system. In 2015, we talked with a group of Māori students who the school and the students themselves and their whānau believed they had achieved education success as Māori. It was right at the end of the school year. And we did this because so many people were saying to us, well, you know, Mere, if I knew what that achieving education success as Māori looked like, then maybe I could do it. So I thought, right. I asked a group of academics who threw up, and there's one of those academics in the room as well, who threw up a model as a straw person for us to let people test. And I thought, who better to test it with than a group of Māori students at the end of their education career who thought they had enjoyed education success as Māori. So we did that from the top of the North Island to the Bluff, and it was one of the most amazing periods of research I've ever done. And this is what they told us. Being able to resist the negative stereotypes. You know, Russell and I found that out in 2009, and I want to go back there in a minute. This was the other thing that they told us. To succeed as Māori, you need to be strong in your Māori identity. The other thing they told us was that they wanted to build on their own experiences as well as the experiences of others in the classroom. The activation of all of the brains in the classroom rather than the one-to-one, one-to-many. This one is not the second bullet point, it's different. Because it's saying, actually, schools in New Zealand, we need to show Māori students that we can celebrate Māori culture. That it's not just being celebrated by brown children. That we don't say, well, the Māori students who are in the Kapa Haka can go to the Polynesian Festival. No. We have to normalise that for everyone. Otherwise, when are Pākehā going to receive the promises that they were made in the Treaty of Waitangi? Experiencing the power of, and I've got two words up there, and two words deliberately. Whānautanga. Whānautanga, a word for birth. So what do we do when children are born into our whānau? And then that notion of whanaungatanga that we're probably more used to, that notion of networking and relationships. I'll just play this through. Final one, being able to contribute to the success of others. Success is not something, and I learned this as a child, is not something that you can say, that success is mine. It's not yours until you start paying it forward. Māori students, at the end of their school career, put on their school uniforms and came back onto the marae to share those amazing stories. And in every marae, we cried, we laughed, and we cried again. The stories were compelling. Compelling stories of 16, 17, and 18-year-old Māori students, some of them very sad, some of them very poignant, but many of them absolutely uplifting. So let's come back to where we are this year. Well, we're in the current situation of communities of learning, or kahuyako, where schools are accessing funding, direct to schools or through the kahuyako. No longer do we have the luxury, the privilege of receiving R&D, research and development contracts from the ministry. If there are them, they're few and far between. And so this is the new world, and it was something that was last year a hard awakening. I don't think just for institutions like our own, I don't think just for teams of people like I work with, but I think for schools as well. At the end of 2016, when we were moving into this arena, I think there was a lot of lack of understanding, a lot of mistrust. We've had a year of this now, where we have a whole new range of difference. And how that is playing out is different in different kahuyako, is different in different communities and in different schools. What we're using our model for, can you see the three ring circus? It's up the top there. We're using it as a theory of change. So that's the theory of change. And we use that theory of change with expert partners. The next step down, we use that theory of change with accredited facilitators. And the third piece of work that we're doing is working with that theory of change through this notion of a blended learning course. Still, it's pretty haphazard because schools get to choose. And where we have got schools that have chosen us as the expert partner, us as the accredited facilitator, and put their hand up for more theoretical gymnastics, we're seeing pretty exciting things happen. And some of the people that we're working with I know are in the room as well, and I want to thank them for coming along. So just to bring us all back to 2018 and say, yay, no more national standards, we got that in the first 100 days. What else did we get? Well, one of the things that we got was the very end of better public service targets for NCEA Level 2. And what I find really interesting about that, if you look at the disparity between Māori and New Zealand European, but one of the things that that actually masks is the fact that we were never going to get 85% for Māori, or even 83.7% for Māori, because so many of Māori students who were born in the year 2000, and this data is about them, had been stood down or expelled or had left our classrooms and schools because they did not feel they belonged. So whatever we did, we as Māori were never going to make that target. And I think we need to remember that. We need to think about that and think about what the implications are for you, whether you're an academic or a teacher, as I said, or one of those really important people, grandparents. This is the other thing that happened at the beginning of the year. We got phase three of Kahikitia. Remember, under the last government, it was going to be stopped at the end of 2017. And so what are we doing this time, right? Well, it's not just about enjoying education successes, Māori. I think we're meant to have ticked that up 2012 or something. No, we're now going for sustained system-wide change. We're going for innovative community iwi Māori-led models of education provision. That'll do it. And Māori students are going to achieve at least on par with non-Māori. Remembering, of course, that we haven't actually achieved kahikitia 1, kahikitia 2, and now we've got phase 3. So by cracking, yes, we are going to have to accelerate whatever it is we do, especially given that at the beginning of the year, this report from NZ Star and the Office of the Children's Commissioner, their research came out. Now, I don't know that there's anything different from the research that Russell and I put into Culture Speaks from 2001. Well, the difference is that it's been 18 years. And when I look at what the students say, and I've picked a bunch out here, well, this Māori student in the secondary school, there's Māori students in Old Ed. Oh my goodness, there's an African student. So I ask myself, what is happening for our refugees? What is happening for our recent immigrants? What chance is there for equity and excellence if they too are forced to fit in our education system, if they too feel that they do not belong? So, almost finally, and it's not too far past 6, I come back to the questions that I asked you at the beginning. What is our role in this? Where is our agency to act? And what will our collective legacy be? I want to leave you with a whakatauki. Mana huruhuru karere te manu. Every feather on a bird is uniquely different. And it's all of the uniquely different feathers that together enable the bird to fly. I would suggest that that's where we have agency. Whether we're one of those really important people, grandparents, hands up the grandparents in the room, yes, whether we're grandparents, whether we're teachers, hands up the teachers, right, whether we're academics, yes, excellent, whether we're Māori, whether we're Pākehā. We must all contribute to this if our birds are ever going to feel that they can fly. For those of you who might want to look at some of the things that I've been through, they're on our website. And there's our amazing group of women, soon to be joined by some amazing men.